Introduction. So good evening everyone, I'm Devashish Bhave.
And I'm Prapti Sao.
On behalf of NPAR, SSS and the Quetta Center for Digital Health, we welcome you all to this fireside chat with Mr. Rizwan Quetta. Mr. Rizwan is the CEO and co-founder of Citius Tech, which achieved the unicorn status in 2019. He was awarded his bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from IIT Bombay and his master's degree in electrical engineering and computer science from MIT. He started off as a senior consultant with McKinsey. He co-founded Citius Tech, is an IIT-B startup, and is responsible for its worldwide business strategy, including healthcare technology innovation and healthcare domain expertise development. He also co-founded Transworks, a leading BPO company, which was acquired by India's third largest business conglomerate.
Sir has much more to be said in his praise. He was awarded the Distinguished Alumni Award at IIT Bombay. He also won the Ernst & Young and Entrepreneur of the Year Award. He was honored with the Young Achievers Award in Business for his contribution towards building stronger business relationships between India and USA. He bagged the Indo-American Corporate Excellence Award for Technology and Communication. Citius Tech was listed in the HCL 100 top healthcare IT companies for 2 years in a row.
IIT launched a new MyMind program and an IEEE DP. In healthcare informatics, so we housed in a new center at IIT, the Quetta Center for Digital Health. Rapi, I think there's an echo. So IIT has launched a minor program and an IEEE DP program in healthcare informatics to be housed in a new center at IIT, the Quetta Center for Digital Health, or KCDH, which has been set up by Mr. Quetta with a vision to make KCDH the first of its kind in India, focused on driving academic programs, research and industry collaboration in digital health. With that, without further ado, let us begin our discussion with Rizwan sir, which would surely give us a lot of insights. We'll start off with a few questions that we had received earlier, and I request you to post your questions in the chat box or unmute and ask at any point of time.
Papi on mute, yeah.
So sir, I'd like to pose the first question to you. You started off as a graduate in electrical engineer and computer science and went into work in consultancy. So what stimulated your interest in the field of digital health?
Got it. So I think it's a good starting point. So first of all, thanks for, you know, providing a very generous introduction. So I really appreciate that. So if you look at my career progression, and I'm just going to take a couple of minutes because, you know, it'll make it real for all the students here. So I graduated from IIT Bombay. At that time, in those days, you know, doing a master's was like the most common thing. It is not like that, I understand, anymore. So we applied, and because I had a good, GPA at that point, CPI, so I got into MIT. So I finished that, but I always wanted to come back to India. And at that time in India, honestly, there were not too many technical career opportunities, you know, like today, if you graduate from IIT Bombay, there are not only big companies like the Microsofts, Googles of the world, but you can also actually do a lot of startup opportunities exist, but which was not the case in those days. So it seemed interesting to take up this management consulting job, but I did it for about 5 years, but wanted to be an entrepreneur. The first company I did was a BPO company, and while the company did quite well, it was not intellectually very satisfying for me, you know, because the nature of the work was such that it wasn't not only not being technical, but it was just much more around business and less to do with innovation. In 2005, when we were looking at our next venture, we scanned the space, and what we were very fascinated by that, we were looking for areas where not too many people were looking at, you know, because if you looked at some of the standard spaces like financial services, if you look at, manufacturing, you look at many other sectors, there are lots of companies doing lots of interesting things. And what we found fascinating is that worldwide, healthcare, we often don't think about it like that. But in any economy, healthcare is between 10% and 20% of the economy. So, for example, U.S., healthcare is about 18% or 19% of the economy. On the flip side, in a place like India, where the healthcare services are very undernourished, right? As a country, it will be a much smaller percentage. But in the Western world, it is anywhere between 10 to 20% of the economy, which is very large, right? There is no other sector which is as large as healthcare, if you think about it from a purely economy perspective. And what we also found fascinating about healthcare is because of the complexity, it is a much more difficult space to become good at. And I say that more to excite students of IIT, you know, it's not to kind of scare you guys away. See, easy problems anybody can do, you know, in some ways, right? But tougher problems, you need smarter guys to do that, right? So because healthcare is a much more involved space, right? It needs more, depth of understanding. It needs more expertise. It's not everybody's cup of tea, right? So let me give you an example. Imagine you have to write a banking software, right? And you may be working on it. Now, whatever you say, right? Somebody has to characterize my bank account and build a software around it, right? If you know, 10, 15 variables, you know, money withdrawn, received, interest rate, bank, you know, I may have invested in mutual funds, the market price would have gone up, gone down, you know, 15, 20, 30 variables, you know, and by and large, you get a sense. Now, if I've invested in 100 stocks, then there'll be 100 times the buying, selling variable, but the concept is the same, right? Imagine I asked you to characterize my physical health, right? Now, my physical health, imagine I'm a patient, I'm suffering from cardiac disease, right? I have a heart disease. Can you imagine the variables that a cardiologist has to see in the heart to be able to quantify what is happening with me, right? Imagine I have a problem with my brain. Then a neurophysician or a neurosurgeon has got hundreds of variables, right, that they want to track related with the brain, right? I may have a problem with a certain other part. I may have a problem with my eyes. An ophthalmologist will have a completely different set of metrics and a different set of data they need to capture. I may have a problem with my kidney, and a nephrologist will have. I may have a lung infection related or not related with COVID or whatever, and there'll be a completely different set of data points that need to get collected, okay? Now, if you look at capturing healthcare information of an individual, right, it's a reasonably complex thing. And the nature of the data could be different, right? It could be medical imaging, right? Medical imaging could be a CT, MRI, X-ray, so many other types of report. It could be lab reports. It could be histopathology reports. It could be other kind. It could be financial information, right? The billing, the claims, all that related with insurance, right? So the world of clinical data and healthcare data is an amazingly fascinating space. Right now, if you could be working in a manufacturing plant and you could be working in Amazon, right? And Amazon may have 500 million products on their website, but the complexity is very limited, you know, because each product has a bunch of, you know, six vendors. The six vendors are putting in inventory. There are people going on the site. They're selecting it, right? The complexity is very different, right? But if you have to characterize, cardiac waveforms, right, and analyze them, right, then the level of sophistication required is very, very different. And that's why, if you look at the world, what you'll find interesting is in industries which are easy to digitize, the world has already made a lot of progress, right? So for example, today, right, you can book a hotel room sitting in your apartment anywhere in the world, right? Because systems talk to each other, right? You want to make a banking transaction, you go to any ATM, doesn't matter whether it's a HDFC bank or a whatever bank, you can go and withdraw money, right? If you want to go to, for example, eat in a hotel or a restaurant, right? You can go look at the Zomato rating, whatever. You want to order food home, right? You know exactly where the guy on your scooty is, right? And you can map the guy, right, as he's coming to your house, right, in some ways, okay? It's pretty obvious stuff, right, which you've got used to, right? Now, imagine there is somebody at home who wants to find an ICU bed in Mumbai. Right? How many stories have we read where people took their dad, their mother in a car or in an auto, went from one hospital to the other hospital to the other hospital to find a hospital bed? And after visiting six hospitals, the patient died. There's something fundamentally wrong in the system, right? And not being able to solve for that, right? In some ways, okay? So the same individual who can order food from a scooty and can get exact mapping is not able to find a hospital bed on time, right? You go to visit a restaurant, and before you get in, you can tell me that there are 5,000 ratings And therefore, these dishes are amazing because it's a crowdsourced information. And you can also get statistics on, you know, what is the rating for ambience and what is the rating for food and for the service and all of that, right? But imagine if my uncle wanted to get a knee replacement. That information is missing, right? How do you find out who's the best knee replacement guy? You go talk to 10 people and see randomly you find somebody, right? Now, today, you want to go to Facebook. Facebook will do advanced algorithms and it will tell you all kinds of things about you and will give you auto-suggest, which it knows, right? You go to a travel site, it'll propose the next best vacation spot based on your history. But imagine you go to meet a doctor and the X-ray has to be read or whatever. They may miss it if they're in a hurry because there was no auto detection software that could have been built, right? To say, by the way, if you get a fracture, right? Then if the system has read 50,000 X-rays, then you can write an AI algorithm for auto detection of an X-ray so that forget whether you get treated using that algorithm, but you can at least have an auto suggest to the doctor so the doctor doesn't miss it. Right, you get to a tumor, right? One of the biggest problems with breast cancer is that early detection fails because doctors miss the tumor, which is there, but it's so small that it gets missed. But you could take together, you know, 10,000 breast cancer images and you can write an algorithm around it, right, in some ways, okay? So the problems in healthcare, right, are often so basic, right, that as a 20, 21-year-old person, right? You have one of two options. Either you say, you know what? It's too complicated. I can't deal with it, right? So let me go and take a banking or a consulting job, okay? Or it fascinates you and say, hey, you know what? This is a space which is so large and is so important, right? And by the way, there is enough opportunity to make money, right? So if somebody told you, right, that you can't make money, then you have to say, no, but I met this guy called Rizwan, right? He actually not only helped solve problems, he also made some money, right? In some ways, okay? So you have to trust me, right, that the opportunity for a career, right, in the space and solving real world problems is just massive. Yeah. Okay. So this was a realization that we had in 2005, right, that, oh my God, when we first started to learn, see, before 2005, I had no idea of healthcare and healthcare technology, right? But fortunately, after having sold my first business, I got 6 months to do some more research. And I was just lucky that I met up with a bunch of people who understood the space really well. And I was able to understand the complexity involved. And the complexity just amazed me, right? In terms of what the opportunities are, right? If one becomes good in the space. And that kind of prompted me to get started. So it was a long answer. So sorry about that. But it kind of covered many of the other areas that, you know, people may have as well, you know, students may have. Yeah. So back to you guys. Yeah.
So, sir, as you mentioned earlier, a lot of people are not aware of healthcare informatics as a field, and it is commonly perceived that it's a very niche field. So, is it really that niche?
So, that is a big misnomer. Let me paint for you what does healthcare involve, okay, right? When you say, so very simplistically, when you think of healthcare, you think of your doctor and you think of your hospital, right? But that's probably 20% of the whole healthcare ecosystem. So, what is the healthcare ecosystem? The healthcare ecosystem obviously consists of doctors and hospitals. It consists of entities which are, pharma companies, because they are investing a tremendous amount of money in research, in all kinds of advancements of healthcare. So they have a massive need for healthcare informatics. There are health insurance companies. In India, it's small, but worldwide, it's a huge area, right? And India also is growing. Number of health insurance companies have grown significantly over the last, 10, 15 years. Then you have companies which are technology companies in healthcare, right? Like, for example, a GE Healthcare or a Fuji Medical System or, Toshiba Medical Systems. You've got a lot of device companies, right, who are building medical devices. It could be pacemakers. It could be, blood glucose monitoring devices. It could be when you go to a hospital, right, you'll find it fascinating that a typical hospital in the US has about 200 applications that run in the hospital, 200 applications. And why do you need 200 applications? So let me give you an example, right? You're a hospital, you'll have to have an electronic medical record system. You'll need to have a system for scheduling your staff because your patient volume changes based on time of day, day of week. You'll need to have a lab information system. You will have an emergency department. You'll need an emergency department system exclusively focused on the needs of the emergency department. You will have an operation theater. The operation theater will have IT systems required for operation theater. You'll have anesthesia, so you'll need anesthesia management system. You will have different departments. You'll have cardiology. So cardiology will have their own cardiac information system, which is all focused around building software, which is required for managing cardiac patients, right? You may be in the ICU. ICU will have tons of software required because, managing ICU, critical care patients, creating alerts based on certain conditions, et cetera. So typical US hospital has tons of clinical applications. In addition, it has lots of other applications. For example, billing systems. For example, ERP systems for managing supplies. For example, they will have procurement systems. For example, they may have patient-facing systems, right? Give you an example, patient portals. One of the big advances that are happening in the world of healthcare is telemedicine, right? Remote patient monitoring. A person just broke his leg. They had a knee surgery. They went back. A lot of the future healthcare is all about keeping patients at home and being able to manage their condition, right? Especially in COVID, right? If you see, the entire healthcare ecosystem in India changed actually in 6 months, where earlier all doctors required you to show up in hospital and to their clinics. Now, increasingly, doctors are very comfortable with remotely managing your situation, whether today, obviously, it's a crude WhatsApp call or some other, simple call like that, but it can get a lot more sophisticated. So the number of organizations from a healthcare ecosystem perspective, right, is not just doctors and hospitals. It includes pharma companies, insurance companies, medical technology companies, healthcare software companies, device companies. It's a huge ecosystem. But most of us, right, don't even know that exists, because, it's not like going to a restaurant or making a hotel booking or taking a flight where all of us get involved, right? When you're 21 years old and, maybe somebody in your family was unwell, so you went visited a hospital, you've never seen the opportunity from your own eyes, in some ways. And that's the fascinating world, which is going to get digitized over the course of the next 10, 20 years in India and, of course, worldwide, creating a massive, massive opportunity for digital health on a global basis. Yeah.
Right. So with that, I'll proceed to my next question. So what does digital health entail, and like how can students and engineers in specific contribute to this field and work in this?
So Prapti, I've kind of given you an overall sense of what it entails, right? It entails all the way from having expertise and collaborating to build clinical applications. I gave you lots of examples of that. It's about having the ability to look at data which is getting generated, right, and analyze them, right? It could be statistical analysis, or it could be using AI machine learning. So AI machine learning in healthcare is exploding worldwide, right? If you can go look out, you do Google. So anything that I'm saying to you guys, right? One of the things I would encourage you all to do is just Google just type simple queries, right? Digital health growth, digital health trends, digital health innovation, healthcare informatics growth. There is a ton of resources online, tons. And you don't have to take my word for it at all, right? But if you type, if you just spend a couple of hours, if it's an area of interest to you, what you'll find fascinating is that, oh my God, this is a space that, the world is competitive. If you are going to join investment banking and all your friends are looking at investment banking, and investment banking has 1,000 smart kids who are all from IITs, then you must recognize that you are the 1,001st kid, okay, out there, okay? In many areas of healthcare, you may be the only smart guy around, okay? And trust me, because I have benefited from that, of being the only guy around, okay, in some ways, okay? So some of these areas, if you feel interested in it and you do a little bit of research on your own, you will be amazed at the opportunity in front of you. I'm just amazed. Okay. So going back to your point, right? What does digital health involve? So it's all around becoming, there's a huge a technology and a clinical application opportunity, right? Building, I told you, a typical hospital in the US has 200 applications, okay? Now, maybe hospitals in India don't have 200. Maybe they only have 20, right? But guess what? In the next 10, 20 years, they're also going to need a lot of software. They're going to need a lot of opportunity to evolve, right? And that's where there's going to be a massive transformation. Digital health is about looking at healthcare data and analyzing it using conventional analytics tools, using AI machine learning tools. Digital health includes consumer health, right? So a lot of healthcare. See, if you look at any of your phones and all the ancillary devices, okay? So today, for example, if you have an iPhone or you have an Android phone, right? Just look at the healthcare features in that phone. And what you will find is that the number of healthcare features which the phone is able to track now, right? Earlier, it was doing basic stuff, right? There was an app for counting calories and all that, like really, really baby stuff, right? Now it's getting serious. Yeah. For example, if you're interested, look up the last couple of videos made by Apple on the new iWatch. And what you will find is that if it's a 3-minute video, 1.5 minutes was devoted to innovation they made in capturing healthcare data on the iWatch. For example, on your iWatch, they can now take an equivalent of your cardiac waveforms. On your iPhone, one of the big, big problems in healthcare, especially for elderly people, is they fall. And when they fall, they break something, you know, and that's one of the huge pain points. And many times when they fall and they break something, there's nobody else around there. So fall detection on your iPhone or iWatch is an interesting application. It's very complicated. Remember, you can't keep on triggering it by person sitting down quickly, right? You have to literally fall. So can you imagine the AI algorithms used in your iPhone for fall detection? Imagine you can build an application for managing life of elderly care and their health by using a cheap Android device. Right? What is the opportunity if you want to be an entrepreneur in the area of digital health, right? It is just a fascinating area that you can do stuff, you know, in some ways. Now, obviously, you will not figure out the ideas and opportunities by in your hostel rooms or by talking to friends at IIT, right? Because how do you know the problem? You know, you're not going to figure it out on your own. So one of the things we are going to be doing, and I'm sure you're going to ask me questions around the Center for Digital Health and what are we trying to do, right? One of the big areas of focus for us, right, is collaborating with healthcare professionals. Okay. So I must tell you, and I know Suli is here as well, right, that we have active conversation going on with Tata Memorial. Okay, Tata Memorial only focuses on cancer, but they have real, cancer is one of the largest diseases, a chronic diseases, right? Cardiac is another one, COPD is another one, right? So these are like 4 or 5 important diseases are the big ones that impact a lot of people as they get older. Diabetes is one of them. Right, in some ways, okay. So cancer is one of the large diseases in this world, and cancer is not one cancer. There are 100 kinds of cancers, right? So partnering with Tata Memorial. So what is Tata Memorial going to do, right? They have clinicians who are super excited about partnering with IIT. Why are they excited about partnering with IIT is because of the fact that IIT students, IIT faculty know skills which they don't understand. They know the problem. They have access to patients. They have access to patient information. But they don't know analytics. They don't know statistics. They don't know biostatistics. They don't know AI machine learning. What if you could pair a really bright student with a very, you know, sort of experienced clinician at Tata Memorial to work on a joint problem. What could come out of that? Quite fascinating, right? This weekend, because there was a press release on the Quetta Center for Digital Health, a lot of people have reached out to me, right? And one of them happens to be one of the top orthopedic surgeons in India. You know, he is one of the leading individuals in knee surgeries in India. He says, Rizwan, I have thousands of images, okay, of people with knees which have problems and knees that don't have problems, right? It takes so long for me to train my staff to figure out what to do, right? Right? Is it possible for me to do something, right? There are knee deformities, and we know how the patient looks before and how the patient looks after. Can I have an algorithm where a patient comes with a knee deformity? I can show them how they will look after the surgery. Now I can tell you that there are probably people on this call who know how to solve that problem. It would be like a summer project for many of you all, right? That you have a person with knee deformity, and if the person if I give you 100 images, then you can create an algorithm where you can give you any new patient and you're going to give me how the patient will look after that, right? For y'all, it may be a summer project. He doesn't have a piece of software that can do that. Now I can give you 5 more examples, but we'll run out of time. So the opportunities, right, whether it's around medical imaging or whether it's about consumer or whether it's about clinical applications, about analytics, AI, I mean, it is a universe out there of things that can be done now. And mind you, it's not just about, there's one thing about, hey, can I get a great job? And the answer is yes. Can I make a lot of money? The answer is yes, right? But there's something more gratifying. Yeah. You know, you could be doing mobile, and I don't have anything against mobile gaming, right? But I could make a case that, you know, solving real world problems in healthcare will be a gratifying experience for you from a career standpoint, or at least evaluate as a career. You know, I don't believe that a 1-year minors program or a IDDP program brands you for life. You know, that way all civil engineers would be branded for 4 years. They're doing only civil engineering. They didn't get branded as civil engineers, and the Meta guys didn't get branded as Meta guys, and people like me in Elect didn't get branded as Elect guys. So I don't think that 1 year in the IDDP or a minor program is going to brand you as a healthcare guy for life. I don't think that's going to happen, right? But it's going to give you an opportunity to do something truly distinctive in a very, very upcoming area where the game has just started, you know. In many areas, I would say, like now, you know, you are building algorithms for optimizing stock market, right? Now that game has been played for like 20 years. Yeah. Now, will you be successful? Of course, you know, some of you guys will be successful in building, because you'll come up with that small incremental enhancement, you'll make a lot of money, right? In some ways. I'm sure that will happen, okay? But here is a completely virgin area, you know, just tons of opportunity, okay? So that's how I would say. So I'll pass it back to you guys. Yeah. Is this, am I saying something which is complicated, Prapti and Devashish? Are you guys able to understand what I'm saying? Yes, I'm trying to make it like very real for you guys, you know, so that it doesn't become esoteric, and I don't want to use jargon, right? But I just want to keep it real for the students. Yeah.
So, sir, I wanted to ask that HITB students from different disciplines might want to pursue HIT as a probable career path. So, but we might not always have backgrounds in CS or biology. So is that a prerequisite? And like, are there any other prerequisites to get into HIT?
I don't think, let me put it like this, right? I think the core understanding of mathematics, of statistics, of computing, which is required, I would say, I don't know whether 90% is the right number or 100% is the right number, but it's 90% of IIT students will have that. Okay. So for example, my co-founder at CTS Tech, his name is Jagdish Murjani. He's a chemical engineer. Another co-founder of mine, Bimal Nayak, who was actually involved in the first 12 years of the company. He also had a chemical engineering background, and Bimal was a deep expert in healthcare, right? In some ways. Okay. The most important thing that I think we're looking for, which will be required, is sort of, you know, three things, right? One is a core understanding of mathematics, which I believe everybody in IIT Bombay has. Two, a very sort of analytical perspective, you know, in some ways, right? Which I would argue that most have, right? And the third one is just the fascination to learn something in a new domain, because what makes it really interesting, okay, and this is, again, maybe I'll take 2 minutes on this one, right? Why is it that digital health in India is going to require a lot more effort? And by the way, when I say a lot more effort, to me, it means amazing opportunity, okay? It doesn't mean problem, okay? Why is it compared to many other countries in the world? And the reason is what happens in India, right, is unlike the US, see, in US, you want to do medicine. You first do an undergrad in any field, and then you can do your pre-med, and then you become a doctor. So I don't know if you guys are aware, but, you know, most doctors in US will have undergrads in many different areas. You could be a computer science undergrad, you could be electrical engineering, you may have done your economics degree, and then you wanted to become a doctor. So pre-med requires you to finish your 4 years of undergrad, and then you apply for your become a doctor. So many doctors in the US already have a background in engineering, because they actually did their undergrad in engineering, and then they went on to do medicine. So when they finish their medicine, they already have a very strong background in math, and, you know, because they were actually engineers in their undergrad degree. In India, what happens is that most students are supposed to choose between this very funny PCB, PCM thing, you know, if you guys are aware of this, right? So you guys are all PCM students, right? I can imagine, because you all appeared for the JEE, right? When you do PCM, then you drop biology in the 10th standard. So most of y'all on the call, including me, have dropped biology in the 10th standard. So we really don't know. We only knew what we had, prepared for our 10th standard board exam. Then we were so happy that we didn't have to do biology anymore. Okay. And all the doctors, right, in India stopped doing mathematics after 10th standard. They were so happy that they didn't have to do mathematics, after the 10th standard, you know, in some ways. Okay. So the world of an engineer has moved away from biology in 10th standard. And see, 10th standard, we all know, right? Only know so much in the 10th standard, right? In some ways. And the world of doctors has moved away from engineering or mathematics, right? In the 10th standard. So now that creates a fascinating opportunity, because in digital health, right, you have to marry the understanding of biology and medicine, etc., with a deep understanding of math and sciences and all of that, right, to be able to put together to create something which is more meaningful. And therefore, it's not possible for a IIT guy or a bunch of IIT guys sitting in there, they can definitely build an app to sell flowers online, right? They could even build an app to, you know, do some other, internet app for code sharing or whatever else. They can do all that, but they can't build a truly healthcare solution very easily, because it needs clinical context. And the clinical guys may be sitting on a huge amount of problems, and they have no idea how to solve it, which may be so obvious to the folks who have the kind of background that IIT students have, you know? Okay. So that's where the opportunity is. That's where the magic is going to happen, you know? And this is going to be something which is extremely practical, and it's going to be something which is going to be real. You know, we're going to try and avoid giving, you know, many times you're just working on some sample data sets and sample stuff and all of that. You know, you kind of do, you'll get your degree, but you don't necessarily get the satisfaction of having worked on something real, right? So one of the things we are trying to do at the Center for Digital Health is trying to make it real, a real life experience, you know, to the extent that we can. Obviously, it's a new center, so we're all working very, very hard. But my personal commitment to IIT Bombay is that, you know, obviously having been in the business and grown a company, we're very well connected to the industry. And one of our commitments is that we will work with the students who join, right? And in a sense, I don't want to say it in as many words, but in some ways it's my commitment, right, to the center to make sure that we give a real experience to the students. At the end of that, right, obviously it's up to the student. You know, you feel so excited that you want to pursue a career in the space, then it's fantastic. If you say, no, I got a great job at McKinsey, so, you know, I'm going to work for a few years at McKinsey, then that will be fine as well, right? So I think that'll be the choice of the student. But we will make sure that we give a very, very positive, experience to each of the students, because I must say that getting the first batch right is going to be critical for the long-term, success of the center. So the first batch is going to be a special batch for all of us, because we're going to work so much harder to make everybody have a great experience. Yeah. So that's the way I would put it, you know.
With this, I would like to ask, what is the situation for the in the employment sector with healthcare informatics, especially what kind of companies hire graduates with degree in healthcare informatics? And what kind of role will this degree play in improving their career prospects?
So I would say, and in a sense, I've already answered that question, but let me answer it slightly differently this time. I think there are five avenues from a career perspective. Okay. It's not necessarily in certain order, but let me just walk through the five. Okay. So the first one is working with what I would call healthcare software companies and device companies, right? And there are a very large number of them in India, right? So right from all the big guys globally have very, very large engineering setups in India, right? I gave a few of the names earlier, like GE Healthcare and Cerner and Philips and Siemens. A lot of those products worldwide actually built out of India, which is not surprising, but that's a huge opportunity, okay? The second big opportunity is working for companies like Citius Tech, right? And there are a whole bunch of companies like that, right from the big guys like Infosys, TCS, Accenture, Capgemini. All these companies do a significant amount of work in healthcare, you know, and the opportunity there is very, very large, right, from a career perspective, right, in some ways, you know. The third broad area, I would say, is working with other Indian organizations, right? So which would they mean? It could be large hospital systems. It could be health insurance companies. It could be those kinds of organizations, and there are many right now, you know, who are doing exceptional work, and there's a lot of opportunity, right? The fourth area is joining research organizations, right? Because you feel so fascinated about this, right? Research organizations, either in India or overseas, you know? So one of the things which is interesting about healthcare for digital health is globally, it is a skill which is in short supply. There's a huge demand, right? So for example, imagine you are a student of IIT Bombay today, right? A lot of students are interested in AI ML, right? And why are students involved and fascinated about AI ML? Of course, it's a very new field, so it's exciting. But secondly, it's exciting because of the fact that the job opportunities are amazing, right? Now, if you know AI ML, then your salary level will not be X, but it may be 1.5, maybe 2X, right? In some ways, okay? So I'll talk more about that in a moment, right? So that is sort of the research. And the fourth is, and the last one is academics, right? Today, if you just go and do research, right? If you look at the top universities in the US, I'm only going to talk about US right now because just keep it simple here. Whether you look at a Harvard, whether you look at Johns Hopkins, whether you look at a Stanford, whether you look at an MIT, you look at Chicago, just look at the caliber of their healthcare informatics programs and the kind of work that they are doing. Columbia, you name it, you know, Duke, whatever, right? You will find that the ability to be able to position yourself into one of these top universities, okay? And this is something that you have to believe in, right? In some ways, it's just fascinating, right? Because guess, and I'm going to make a simple argument for it, right? Imagine somebody wants to apply to Stanford, right? And you want to apply in electrical engineering or computer science, right? I mean, how many students are applying to Stanford for the standard AI computer science degree? I mean, there are hundreds and thousands there, right? And therefore, it is very competitive to get into Stanford, yeah, because you're trying to get into Stanford as an, why, what is your interest? It's AI machine learning, right? But imagine you wanted to get to Stanford and you were interested in digital health, right? And you could say, by the way, you know, we worked with this, I'm going to take any of the examples I've already given you, right? I won't create a new one, right? I worked with this orthopedic doctor, and this is a paper that we got published, and this is what we did in taking real data for knee deformity and being able to improve that. I can make a case any day, right, that your odds of going into Stanford have just gone up by at least some multiple. I don't know whether the multiple is 2 or it's 5 or it's 10. I don't know that. But you'll be talking about something that nobody else in your peer group is going to be talking about. Yeah. But if you're going to be talking about, hey, by the way, we took some, you know, generic data set online and then we massaged it and this we did analysis, whatever may be the case, right? I think there are many other kids doing that. And many other students doing that, you know. How do you really differentiate yourself, right? But if you can move the needle on a hard problem, okay, and on an area with not too many people are working, right? So I just, I just hope I communicate across in this meeting today, right? Is guys, if you want to have a differentiated career, right, then you have to do something differentiated, right? If your input is the same, but you're expecting a different output now, then I don't think you are being fair to yourself. Yeah. So you have to look at it and say, hey, you know what? What am I, what truly inspires me? What truly excites me, right? Then if it is truly exciting and inspiring, then I will take the leap of faith. Yeah. You know? So did I broadly answer your question, Prapti? So don't be worried about lack of job opportunities, okay? I think there are lots of job opportunities out there, okay? Real job opportunities. Will they pay as much as Goldman Sachs? Probably not, right? Will they pay as much as, you know, Tower Research? I mean, I don't know. I just get to hear from, you know, some of the students, right? Some of these names, I didn't even know they existed when I was on campus, you know? Or consulting organization, they probably won't pay that much, right? But what it may do for you, which some of these other jobs may not do, is it may land you in a spot where 5 years from today, you may have a career pathway, you may be making 5x the amount of money you made, right? Then you would be working in any of these organizations. Why? Because you crack something new, right? It'd be very hard to do that in a consulting job. Trust me, you know? Right. Then you join high and then you remain there. Right. Here you may not be at that same level, but then you can leapfrog. Yeah. You know, because it's a exciting, you know, world out there. Right. Where there is lots of opportunity. Yeah.
So, sir, I think now we've had a rough understanding of what digital health is as a career path. So now I think we would like to move on to the center. So, sir, what was your vision behind establishing the KCDX?
When we started Sirius Tech, you know, in 2005, we knew very little about digital health. You know, we were just getting started. We took a leap of faith. We said, hey, there's an opportunity. And then over 16 years, we work with literally hundreds of organizations. And we were fortunate that in many cases, right, we were working with some of the largest and best known names in the industry, right? And we were working with them to build their software, build their next generation of tools, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, many times you get lucky because you are standing on the shoulders of giants, right? So you get a little bit of a view which you never get standing on the ground, right? So we would never know how does Microsoft think about healthcare? How does Google think about healthcare? What is happening in Verily? What is happening with some of these large healthcare software and device companies? How are large hospital systems like, you know, Mayo Clinic and Johns Hopkins, and how are they innovating? What is happening in the world of pharma, right? And so you never get to know that unless you have had the opportunity to collaborate with some of these organizations. So we were just, in a sense, lucky that when we got started in Sirius Tech in 2005, the customers that we worked with and the kind of work we did and what we learned about what is happening there, right, gives us an extremely strong perspective of how healthcare has evolved and healthcare technology and digital health has evolved worldwide in the last 15, 20 years. Now, why is that important? That is important because, you know, when you've seen this thing happen in country after country, especially these larger countries, right, you know that it is a precursor of what are the opportunities that happen in a poorer parts of the world like India and others, right, in some ways, okay? So if you look at a country like India, right, obviously there are things that we benefit because of the fact that there are, we just derive value from what happens in the world. Like I'll use vaccines as an example, right? In India, we are all deriving value from the fact that AstraZeneca developed a vaccine in Oxford and they were able to crack a certain code, and that code is now available to in India, and we are manufacturing in India, right, in some ways. Today, you go to a hospital and you look at the hospital is using a Konica Minolta, imaging system, and they are using their electronic software from some other big company in the world. Why? Because that development has happened there, and it's now in India also benefits, right? I was talking to a cardiologist, right? And today, a cost of a pacemaker that India buys, where do we buy pacemakers from? There are 3-4 companies in the world that have a monopolistic position in pacemakers. So India, in all country, all doctors in India, you go, your pacemaker is bought, from those companies. The pacemaker may cost you 50,000 rupees, it may cost you 2 lakhs, it may cost you 3 lakhs. But the electronics behind the pacemaker is not terribly different from, I'm only trivializing it for the purposes of example. So please don't take it in the literal sense, right? But a calculator, electronics, and a pacemaker may not be that terribly different. Of course, there'll be some device characteristics and anti-corrosion, this, that, some fancier equipment will be used. So it should be whatever, right? But it is possible that you could actually pay a pacemaker not for 50,000 and 2 lakh of rupees, but you could actually make it for 5,000 rupees, right? Just imagine the number of people, forget India, but in half of mankind, right? In some ways, right? What the opportunity, and forget people you're going to save. See the amount of money you will make as an entrepreneur, right? Who's just figured out how to make it, right? Right? Your company will be definitely worth $1 billion, if not multiple billion dollars, if you crack that problem, right? In some ways, right? So overall, right, I feel that the opportunity, right, is very, very, very significant. Yeah. I don't know whether I fully answered your question.
Yes.
Okay. Anybody has? Are you guys reading questions that have come online as well?
Yes, sir.
We're running out of time. If there are a couple of questions, I can go over a little bit, but otherwise, I know we'll be at the hour.
Go ahead.
I wanted to ask, those students who are not pursuing a minor on an IEEE DP and they are interested in healthcare informatics, since it's only open to UG students right now. So, how can any student avail internships in this sector and build a profile in healthcare informatics? And does the center have any provision for supporting such students who are interested in availing internships in this sector?
Honestly, I don't know how to answer that question, Prapti, because I'll let the faculty of the KCDH answer that question, because IIT has its own protocols, right? So I have to be, my main role is to help IIT and the center establish external collaborations. So I spoke about partnering with hospitals. We spoke about partnering with, healthcare software company, device companies, insurance companies. So that's where I'm going to be spending a lot of my time helping the center, right? Creating opportunities for collaboration, internships, potentially jobs and others. But what is the internal protocol of IIT? Which students can apply, which can't, what is the criteria, etc. Those are things which internally within IIT, they will define. So it's a very good question, but unfortunately, I should not be answering that question. Somebody from the center, the faculty from IIT, should be answering that question.
Hello, this is Ganesh here.
Yeah, Ganesh.
I think So I think there have been a couple of questions, and the latest one has been about facilitating healthcare informatics for students outside the BTech program, right? So we'll be soon opening up PhD and master level entrances, and also some other. We'll also try facilitating in other ways, and also some fears about bio, etc. We must say that the core course is going to basically facilitate any kind of priming the students would need in healthcare, and thereafter the CS101 course that you all do, and then there's a basic data analysis course you do, that should be sufficient from a CS perspective. Anything additional will be you'll be guided by the faculty member who is actually handholding you in the dual degree project, or maybe going forward even the PhD program. So Professor Sivili, would you like to add something to this?
Yeah, for the internship question, so the same protocol will be followed as in other departments. So if outside students want to apply, they can write to us. Once the website is out, they can see like who are faculty in that center, and they can write to us, email us, or call us in our offices, and then the same protocol will be followed.
I just want to add, I think students are a little scared about healthcare and bio. I think I mentioned on the chat that I'm just coming back from South Mumbai from a meeting with BMC. I know BMC has been trying to tackle COVID. Rizwan alluded to do that at the beginning of his talk. I must say that some background knowledge in healthcare is really important. I mean, if you're just going to be driven by data analytics without grounding yourself in the basic knowledge of healthcare, you'll be trying to probably fit a square peg in a round hole. So, and as far as the basics are concerned, the course will cover. You don't need to be overly scared about healthcare. I mean, it's after all your and my health that we're talking about. So, and I think it's not going to be overwhelming at all. So be rest assured, this is going to be an exciting program. Thanks.
Yeah, and also I think, Professor Ganesh, if I can just add on, I believe that the curriculum will provide, the basics of biology and some of the background information that will be relevant for students. And I must also add that one of the things we're trying to do as part of the tie-ups is to actually get faculty from some of the leading entities, around Mumbai and potentially around India, to come and conduct these classes, either conduct the whole course or as guest lecturers in these programs. So it will be quite fascinating because, we do anticipate that this program will get enriched by bringing in faculty from outside IIT as well. So I know that the core team of KCDH is working very hard on coming up with a very interesting curriculum, which is going to take inspiration from what are globally well-known and good programs, but also going to enhance the overall quality by bringing in faculty from the outside. So we are hoping that this is going to be a very sort of rich experience for all the students there.
So I think that answers all our questions. If anyone from the audience has any questions, please feel free to unmute and ask or post on the chat.
Okay, so I see many, many comments which were posted here. So I'm hoping that we have kind of covered all of this. If you guys are okay, we can wrap this up. And this was quite an exciting conversation. I hope some of my enthusiasm around the digital health will have a positive rub-on effect on some of you guys. So I hope that happens. But I must say that in summary, right, extremely fascinating area, a little less understood, which actually makes it even more interesting for people who are willing to tread down a path of something which is new. It is not a niche area. It's a huge area worldwide. Please go and do your own research, and my request to you is, if it's even modestly interesting to you, spend 2 hours, on a weekday, weekend, whenever you have time, and just type these words in Google, digital health innovation, digital health growth, healthcare, technology trends, whatever, right? And just read about it for 2 hours. And my commitment to you is that at the end of the 2 hours, right, you will make a much more informed decision on how you want to take it forward. If there's any help you need from the core team, obviously you'll go and ask. But if there are any specific questions, right, imagine, for example, there are half a dozen of you guys and you all are like right on the borderline. Should I do it, not do it, whatever, right? And you guys have any open questions, I'll be very happy to engage and, you know, answer some of those questions if required. So this is part and parcel of our commitment to, you know, ensuring that we get the center off to an awesome start. Yeah. So thank you very much, everyone. And this was a pleasure talking to you guys today. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.